Well, Happy New Year, Lincoln Glen Church. We're so glad you are with us today in our worship. And we want to give thanks to the Lord. We want to praise Him for being so good to us. Let's worship together. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For He is good, He is above all things. His love endures forever. We'll sing praise. Stretched on, His love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, His love endures forever. We'll sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, everyone, sing praise. From the rising to the setting sun, His love endures forever. And by the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. We'll sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. We'll sing praise, sing.
Here we go. One, two, three, and. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mine? So much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who in the breathless, in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing. This is unfailing love, that You have taken my place, that You would bear my cross, You would lay down Your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that You've done. Amazing grace. the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be saved. You've done for me.
All right, good morning. Happy New Year. My name is Tyler. I am one of the pastors here at Lincoln Glen Church. Want to let you know about some things we have going on. Starting next week, we are starting a brand new series through the book of Philippians. And so we invite you to join along with us. And there's one thing you can do to prepare for that if you want. There is a website called The Bible Project. And in there, they have these videos that give an overview of books of the Bible. And so if you want to come and check that out and so that you can get a little bit more acquainted with the book of Philippians, we're going to put the link right about here or here, wherever Joseph puts it. And so you can check that out for yourself and kind of get with us. Along with that, we are starting a new Bible reading plan this month. So you can get that on our website. Get that on our social media, and it might look like a typo on there. The book of Philippians is on there multiple times. We're going to be, because we're going through the book of Philippians on Sunday mornings in our sermon series, we're encouraging you to go along with us in your Bible reading plan at least once a month, multiple times a month, some months in our Bible reading plan. So join with us as we dive in to this beautiful book. We want to let you know, too, we have something coming up on the 24th of this month outside, very social distance. We were going to have just a few people that are going to come and help provide some hygiene kits for homeless people. And so if you want to be some of those few people, go to our website, lincolnglen.org, where you can find out more information and how you can sign up for that. Again, spots are going to be super limited. We're going to do a lot of social distancing and make that as safe as possible to help those that are in need in our community. We're going to pray for our offering in just a moment. And so you can give if you'll see in just a minute how you can do that. But we want to pray and thank God for the chance that he gives us to participate in the kingdom in that way. And for our offering song, we are going to have Wita Dill, who, if you are part of Lincoln Glen Church, you know Wita. You've gotten a hug from Wita. If you don't, she is a sweet woman. And we want to be praying because her husband, David, who many of you know, is at the Lincoln Glen Manor with COVID. And so we want to be praying for him, be praying for other people that are dealing with COVID right now. And for our healthcare workers and all of that. So let's pray for our offering. Let's pray for people impacted by COVID. And then we're going to be very blessed with Wita singing a very special Christmas song. Even though it's not technically Christmas anymore, we're just going to keep celebrating it here. So we're going to have that special song from Wita in just a moment. But let's pray. Lord, we thank you that you give us the opportunity to give, to participate in your kingdom. And we pray that what we would give out of a generous spirit, knowing that it goes to impact your kingdom all around the world. And Lord, we pray for David. We pray for anyone else that has COVID right now, that you would heal them, that you would bring relief. Lord, that you would help this to be as pain-free as possible. So, Lord, we pray for David and everyone else that's going through this, the healthcare workers who are on the front lines. And we continue to pray that you would bring an end to this terrible disease and help us to be the hands and feet of Jesus in the meantime. Lord, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
could not see. We didn't know it was you. Long time ago, when you was born in a manger, Lord, my sweet little Jesus, Jesus boy. Just seems like we can't do right. Look how we treated you.
Right now, we are going to be joined by a guest preacher who we've had before. She was very well received. Her name is Felicia Larson. She is a pastor at Awakening Church just down the road in San Jose. And so here is her sermon right now for us.
Hello, Lincoln Glen Church. My name is Felicia Larson, and I am so excited to get to be with you today. When your pastor and my friend Tyler reached out to me just a few weeks ago about speaking today, I was so excited because I've been keeping in step with your messages on It's Better to Give Than to Receive series. And I was just praying and asking God, what would He want me to share with you? Not necessarily in that regard, but as I prayed, there was a connection in what God gave me to the series that you guys have been in. And so today I'm going to be sharing with you about stewardship, but from a little bit of a different angle. You see, as Tyler has talked about stewardship and managing, he said that it's not just about money, but that we steward our time, our treasure, and our talents. And so today, God just wants us to talk about how to steward our stories. How do we steward the pain of our stories, the struggles we've had, the highs and the lows? I want to ask this question. How do we manage the struggles, the shortcomings, the challenges, and even the addictions that we have wrestled with throughout life, the things we've overcome? James 5:16 says it this way, confess your sins to one another and pray for each other that you may be healed. Part of the process of growth and stewardship is to confess things to each other and then to pray, because that verse goes on to say, just after that, that the prayers of a righteous person are powerful and effective. Well, that's only because of the redeeming power of God in our life to redeem and change the things that we are confessing. James 1:2 tells us to count it all joy when we face trials of many kinds. Well, we can count it all joy because we know that God has a purpose in the things that we face. And 2 Corinthians 1, verses 2 through 4, talks about the God of all comfort. So the trials we face sometimes require that we be comforted through them. And so God brings comfort into our lives during the trials that we face so that we can comfort others. All that to say that as we steward the pain, the struggles, the difficulties of the things that we have been through in life and the stories that we have, if we're honest about our faults and we face trials with an expectation that God has designed them for a purpose, and we actually remember that sometimes we have to be uncomfortable to receive comfort, I don't know about you, but I would rather God protect me, keep me safe, and let nothing go wrong in my life. But I have to remember that I live in a fallen world and that those things are going to touch my life. And so rather than run from them, we use them as something that God has entrusted to us to go through, so that when other people go through things, we can help them. But there's also another purpose for them. It's so that God can shape our life to bring glory to Him. If 2020 taught us nothing else, it's that none of us is exempt from the chaos of this broken and fallen world that we live in. We're just 3 days into 2021, and I'm not sure how you're feeling about it so far, but we would do ourselves and the world a disservice to simply turn the page on 2020 and the variety of lessons that it had for us. The ways God used it to expose faults, to build character, and to bring comfort. Many of us have been so focused on turning the page and getting out of 2020 that we haven't stopped to ask, what may I have been supposed to take out of that chaotic experience? Rather than run from it and leave it in the past, forgetting it, let's ask this all-important stewardship question. How can you steward the pain of your story to allow it to shape your character and to bring God glory? Can God get glory out of setbacks and the sins that we've struggled with? Let's ask it another way. Is there something in your story that can be a testimony for those watching your life? Thinking back over 2020 and some of the cracks that were exposed, I want to just share a little bit from my life that may spark some thoughts for you. So, being an introvert, I thought, oh, shelter in place will be easy. I'm not going to miss hanging out with people because I keep my circle pretty small. But early on in the process, I realized that the few interactions I have to be severely reduced made me feel lonely. And scripture already tells us that it's not good for us to be alone, so I came to a better understanding of what that felt like. As a pastor, it was difficult for me to watch people that I care for so much struggle and to try and figure out how to help them. I mean, it's not just part of my job description to care, it's part of my DNA. And so I was trying to figure out, going through my own struggles of just understanding a pandemic. I'd never been through one before, and neither had the people that I was serving. So I had to learn to ask new questions. Like, it exposed my leadership capacity. I had to learn to be creative and to take each moment as it came rather than planning things out the way I like to normally. I had to be willing to say, I don't know. And yet I realized that even though I didn't know, my people still needed me to lead. And as a parent, walking alongside my adult children, because you never stop being a parent no matter how old they get, 2020 highlighted something actually kind of cool for me. It was how I had grown in flexibility and adaptability that God had been cultivating in me for years. That was a quite timely and pleasant surprise. So listening to my remembrance may have sparked some thoughts for you. And so maybe after today's message, you take some time and think through some of the things that 2020 exposed or highlighted for you, for your family, for colleagues and coworkers, and for your congregation. While many of us would like to just leave the past in the past, our exposed cracks, even, you know, some of the things that we've learned and highlighted the growth of how we've changed. Let me just say this. No matter what, when things come into our lives, what we realize is that we will never be the same. Let me submit to you that your struggles from the past have shaped your character. And things from your past have also revealed your character. Character in the Greek has this idea of a stylus. So we think of stylus and we think of that little rubber-tipped thing that we use on our phones or on other glass framed pieces of technology. But an old school stylus had a sharp tip. It was an instrument used for carving. I mention this because trials in the hands of an almighty God are a stylus to shape us. That's why James 1:2 tells us to count it all joy when we face trials, because God is shaping our character and writing a story with that instrument. Like a carpenter or a sculptor, God has a shape in mind when he looks at our lives of what the end product will be. And so he goes to work on our lives using instruments and elements and things that are coming to our life to shape us, to get to the end product that he has in mind. Let's take a look at James 1 verses 2 through 8. Now, you may be thinking to yourself, I don't want to hear count it all joy or trust in the Lord, but can I just tell you that while these things may sound cliche, they're not. I pray that as you listen today, that the Spirit of God will open your ears and impress upon your mind these things to receive them in a new way, that you might hear them differently than you have before in light of some things that you've been through and in light of some things I'll share today. So let's take a look at James 1 verses 2 through 8. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. But when you ask, you must believe not doubt, because the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea blown and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Such a person is double-minded and unstable in all they do. The best way to explain this and unpack it is to focus on verse 5. That talks about asking for wisdom. So often, we take that out of context and just go, well, if you ask for wisdom, God gives it generously. But the wisdom in context is to be asking about, God, what are you up to with the things that are happening in my life? Now, you may have asked that question in 2020. You may have asked that question about things that have come into your life throughout your life. And what the passage is telling us is that God can share with us wisdom about what he's up to in and with our life. Now, you may get specific answers, but the longer you walk with God, you begin to realize that while he may not give specific answers, he gives us wisdom on how to walk through it in a way that we come out the other side better for the trial that we're going through. And so we get just this feeling of peace. We get an understanding of, okay, I can trust God because when I went through something like this before, that He brought me out on the other side. And so He becomes more trustworthy. But He also gives us wisdom sometimes about maybe there's a fruit of the Spirit that He's trying to develop in our lives, or maybe there's a place where He's trying to grow us to make us better or just different than we were before. What helps us to understand this a little bit better is another well-known verse in Proverbs 3, 5 through 7, and it will help us to make some other connections. So let's take a look at that. Proverbs 3, 5 through 7 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. And all your ways submit to Him, and He will make your paths straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and shun evil." Okay, so now let's connect this passage to James 1. So remember at the end of that pericope there in James 1, verses 2 through 8, a passage there, it says, we be tossed back and forth for those who doubt. Well, doubting doesn't mean that you can't ask God or say, I don't understand why this is happening to me, or struggle with that. Doubt means, in this case, that instead of relying on God's wisdom, I rely on my own wisdom. That's why I bring up Proverbs 3, because when it says trust in the Lord with all your heart, that means don't trust your own wisdom. When it says lean, we may think like just propping something up against a wall. But in this instance, lean means to put the full weight upon that. And so sometimes we put the full weight upon our own understanding. And isn't it funny that we serve an all-knowing God who is infinite, and yet we trust our own finite experiences and our own finite understanding of things. It sounds kind of silly when you hear it out loud, and yet it's just so human of us, right? We often find it difficult to trust the Lord because we can't control Him, and yet He is trustworthy. Relying on Him is the wisest thing we could do. But when we decide to lean on our own understanding, that's what causes us to go back and forth and feel like nothing is stable. When we don't understand what God is up to in the trials that we face, the only answer is to ask Him for wisdom and then trust that He is faithful, that He is faithful to give us exactly what we need to understand, to take the next step, to do the next right thing. But God says in His word, one more really familiar verse, let's take a look at Hebrews 11, 6. "And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who earnestly seek Him." So the important part about sharing this verse is that He rewards those who earnestly or diligently seek Him. In the Greek translation, that word earnest is not there. It's just the word exateo, which means to seek. But in this kind of seeking, it is an earnest or diligent kind of seeking. That's why in English it's translated that way. And what that means is to pursue with a deep sincerity, to take a matter seriously. So as we try to steward the broken things that happen in our lives, or the ways that God tries to shape us that are uncomfortable, if we have faith and we seek Him with deep sincerity about this matter that's so serious to us, what happens is that God helps us to understand that it's more blessed to receive His molding and shaping of our lives so that we can then give out of that molding and shaping something that can be helpful to our life as well as to those who we walk alongside. So as we own our faults, we share the lessons that we've gained through the character shaping trials, and then we also share the comfort that we were comforted with as we walked through the difficulties that we faced. In that way, nothing that we go through is wasted. As God deposits into our life things, we can then withdraw from them and help to deposit something good into another person's life. Here's how scripture says it in Romans 8:28. It's not something that we're going to look at, but I just want to share with you that in that verse it says that God works out all things together for the good of those who love him, those who are called according to his purpose. You may be watching this and you may be thinking that I don't have that relationship with God, and so how is he going to work everything out for my good? Well, I would say to you that 2021 could be your year to step into relationship with God, to be able to claim some of these promises that if we trust in him and not lean on our own understanding, he'll make our paths straight, that we could count it all joy because God is up to something in our lives. But there's also something that before we step into relationship with God, and even as we're in relationship with him, that we continue to struggle with, and that, my friends, is temptation, where God brings trials into our lives to shape us. We have an enemy who crafts temptations to break us. Let's take a look at James 1 again, but verses 13 through 15 that say this: when we are tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. Then after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. What I want you to hear here is that sin breaks us, mars us, and yet there is a God who takes the pieces that are broken in our life and makes something good out of them. Okay, we hear sin and we think, oh, that's such a harsh word. But we know that we don't even live up to our own expectations. And so sin, in its truest essence, is to fall short of what God has designed for our lives, to fall short of God's expectations for us. And so we know if we fall short of our own expectations, that we fall short of a perfect God's expectations. Now, he doesn't require us to be perfect. Jesus already did that for us. As we celebrated Christmas just over a week ago, that's what that whole story is all about, is that there is a God who stepped into history, Emmanuel, God with us, to make right the things that are wrong, so that the things that have come into my life, that when I have been enticed or desired something, that I have fallen into those temptations, Jesus came to live a perfect life that I could not live, and that I then get to receive that as part of grace from God. But then there's also sins that other people were enticed to that may have impacted my life, and those are the things that I then have to steward and bring to God, those broken pieces, and ask him to help me with them, to redeem them, to restore me from the broken things that have happened. Some of us may be convinced that we've done things that God can't forgive. Others of us may be convinced that God doesn't care about the things that were done to us. And can I just tell you, both of those are wrong. When you bring the broken pieces of your life to God, no matter how they got that way, he cares about you and he wants to help you be restored. He wants to take those broken pieces and give you an understanding of the things that have come into your life. Now, all of them weren't good, and not all of them were part of his will for your life. They're just part of being in a broken and fallen world. But what God's plan is for our lives is that brokenness does not get the last word on our story. God wastes no part of our story. And how he redeems it is he makes us new through this process of sanctification, a big churchy word that just means God takes the yucky things of our life and turns them over and reveals to us some of the things that can be useful in them. It reminds me of this old Japanese art form called kintsukuroi. Kintsukuroi is in English called gold mending. So practitioners of this art, rather than getting rid of broken pieces of pottery, they put them back together using gold adhesive that actually draws attention to the broken places. That when these pieces are put together again, they're unique and actually more beautiful and stronger than they were before. That sounds just like how God enters into our lives. When we accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, it is the gold of Him living on the inside of us that permeates the cracks and the breaks of our story and shines out through them. And then God puts His Holy Spirit in us that covers over the broken and marred places in our life and makes us beautiful and stronger. Let me read one more verse to you out of 2 Corinthians 4, verses 5 through 7, that might make this all come together for us. It says this: "For what we preach is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness,' made His light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us." You see, our lives are a testimony. They preach about the goodness of Christ. And what Scripture says is that we have this great thing in a jar of clay, in an earthen vessel that has been shaped by trials, marred by temptations, and all the while, God can use all of it to make something beautiful. You see, God has deposited a story in you and me for us to steward with all its joy and pain. If you have not decided to follow Jesus yet, I hope you do today. I hope that you give your broken pieces to Him. For those of us who have come to know Jesus already, we too can give the broken pieces of our story to Him as He then moves them into a place of redemption and restoration. We can then steward them as a way of sharing with others what this restoration process is like. Realize that you will be stepping into this shaping process where we discover and then surrender. We take it from me that as someone who's been on this journey for over 40 years, I'd rather be shaped by God than marred by the world. And yet both happen as we walk through life. And then God entrusts to us as we lean on Him for wisdom, as we trust in Him, and as we have faith in Him that He's up to something good. And then the world that needs to know that Jesus is real and that He's worth believing in can look at our lives of trust and begin to see the wholeness that God is creating as He fills in those cracked places and spaces, and that He makes us stronger and more beautiful as He works through the story of our life. Let's pray together. Father, thank You for this time to get to be with my family at Lincoln Glen. I pray, God, that You would bless them as they start 2021 and as they begin to steward the story, not only of 2020, but of their lives. God, would You just help them to be able to know that You are a good Father who loves them, who won't leave them broken, but You will take the pieces of life and put them together in such a beautiful way. Thank You for all that You do to redeem and resurrect and restore lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
We want to celebrate coming together and remembering the Lord's death for us as we celebrate this time of communion together. Listen to some encouraging scriptures that speak truth into our lives.
This is from John 3:16-18. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son.
Jesus said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's take the bread together. I invite you to listen to another scripture that talks about God's amazing, overwhelming love for us.
From Romans 5:8, we hear, "But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us."
Jesus said, "This is my blood, which is poured out for you. It is for the forgiveness of our sins." Let's remember him as we drink the cup. Amen. To God be the glory.
Perfect in all call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still into love, love, love.
You're a good, good Father.
It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are.
And I'm loved by you.
It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
You're a good, good Father.
It's who you are. It's who you are. Who you are,
and I'm loved by you.
It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me.
Your foe, still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. Been so, so kind to me.
Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me.
shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
There's no shadow.
There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
Only over.
To end our time, I just want to again pray for people who are dealing with COVID. Pray for all of us who are going through different things, and just pray that we can take the words that we heard from Felicia and have our lives be changed. So let's do that. Lord, again, we pray for David Dill and anyone else that is going through COVID right now, that you would heal them. Lord, again, be with our healthcare workers and everyone who's out there on the front lines dealing with COVID. And we pray that we can take the words that you spoke through Felicia, and that you would change our hearts and help us to live differently because of how we encountered your word this morning. And so we pray that in Jesus' name, amen.